The Art of War by Sun Tzu is an ancient book which talks about numerous military tactics. It has been used by high-powered executives, military leaders, and politicians even in recent history because the lessons from this book are timeless. Now, you might be thinking that if you're not in the military, then why would you want to read this book? Well, the simple answer is that most of us are engaging in all kinds of small war in our daily lives. Every time you wake up in the morning and don't want to get out of bed, you're waging a war with your laziness. Even if you're trying to negotiate a higher salary, you're waging a war with your boss. Now, the point here is to not give you a pessimistic view of the world where you imagine that everyone is against you and you think about fighting a war all the time. It's about putting yourself in a position to succeed. And before I begin this video, I want to urge you to keep an open mind and be creative about how you can apply these principles in your own life. It may not be obvious right off the bat as to how you can use them in your everyday life. But let them sink in. Think about it for a few days before forming an opinion. Don't dismiss these principles as violent and only for the military. They are very applicable in our everyday lives. Principle number 1, laying plans. According to Sun Tzu, all warfare is based on deception. Hence, when we are able to attack, we must seem unable. When using our forces, we must seem inactive. When we are near, we must make the enemy believe that we are far away. And when far away, we must make him believe we are near. This principle can be essentially boiled down to one thing. Do not show all your cards. If you're in a business negotiation and you show all your leverage right from the start, then you lose the advantage. The general who wins the war makes many calculations in his head before making any move. It's a lot like playing chess. You need to think about the consequence of each move you're making and what the enemy is going to respond with and how you're going to counter that. So let me give you a very real situation you might find yourself in. Let's say you're negotiating for a higher salary with your boss, and you tell him that you have a better offer elsewhere. You tell him that you're going to move on unless you're compensated for in a better way. So now your boss might ask you, what offer do you have? Here is where deception comes into play. If you lay all your cards on the table and tell him exactly what the offer is and who is giving it to you, he might pull some strings behind your back and get that offer taken away from you. Then you will have no leverage. But if you don't give up that information and you're able to handle the situation in a tactful way, then your chances of getting your salary increase a lot more. Principle number 2 is waging war. Sun Tzu says, no country has ever benefited from prolonged warfare. When you're at war, you're going to drain your resources. Your soldiers will get tired, their weapons will get dulled, and because of this, you're more likely to make mistakes. You might do something rash or you might get yourself killed. This is why you have to remember the cost of war before you engage in it. Don't get into fights that you cannot afford to lose. A lot of companies do this. They get into price wars with each other and they keep decreasing their profits until they're both essentially not making any money. This kind of fighting will not benefit anyone, which is why you should know when to pick a fight. Another thing Sun Tzu tells us is that in order to fight ferociously, the soldiers need to be roused with anger. Now, in the modern world, we aren't really doing a lot of killing, but this does in a way translate to the business world. All it means is that if you want to win, the people on the front lines need to be motivated. So for example, if you're leading a team of salespeople, then you could motivate them by saying whoever gets to the target first will win a trip to a foreign country or something to make them more motivated. Principle number 3 is attack by stratagem. Sun Tzu says, in the practical art of war, the best thing of all is to take the enemy's country whole and intact. To shatter and destroy it is not so good. If you think about it, this makes a lot of sense. If you take the enemy's country and destroy it from the inside, then you will have no one left to rule over. This is why in ancient wars, a lot of times the conqueror wouldn't kill the king, they would just ask them to bend the knee. This allows for the country to remain intact and it keeps violence at bay. The same thing can be said for a business situation. Sometimes a bigger company might buy a smaller company and they fire most of the people. This is not the best way to inspire confidence. Another saying in this chapter is, if you know the enemy and know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles. If you know yourself but not the enemy, for every victory gained, you will also suffer a defeat. If you know neither the enemy nor yourself, you will succumb in every battle. This means that you need to have self-awareness and knowledge about the enemy if you really want to win. This can be used to build better habits. For example, if you want to lose weight, then your enemy is sugar. So if you have knowledge about yourself, when you eat sugar, why you can't stop eating it, etc. And if you know about sugar, which foods contain it, how you can reduce it, etc. Then you can win the war with obesity. Principle 4 is tactical dispositions. Sun Tzu says that the victorious strategist only seeks battle after the victory has been won, whereas he who is destined to defeat first fights and afterwards looks for the victory. This means that you have to first make yourself as strong as possible and then wait for the right moment. So in a business situation, if you want to compete with another company, you don't go all out guns blazing on the first chance you get. You first make sure that you're in the strongest position possible, and then you wait for your competitor to make a mistake, and then you attack at the right time. This is called being patient and being smart. Principle number 5 is energy. This principle basically talks about the fact that you have to be clever with how you spend your energy. You don't have unlimited energy. If you want to move a heavy block of wood, instead of pushing it, why not make wheels for it so it can be rolled easier? The clever person will figure out a way to conserve energy and use it in the right way, and that can be crucial for winning any situation. Principle 6 is weak points and strong points. So in war, the way is to avoid what is strong and to strike at what is weak. This might seem very obvious, but a lot of people don't do this. Let's say you're running a company and if you know that your competitor can outprice you, then why even compete on price? Why not compete on quality or customer service? Don't try to hit them where they're strong, hit them where they're weak. Principle 7 is maneuvering. Why do you think small startups are able to capture so much of the market, while bigger companies are not able to do anything about it? This is because smaller companies can outmaneuver larger companies. Sun Tzu says, it is a military axiom not to advance uphill against the enemy, nor to oppose him when he comes downhill. Do not pursue an enemy who simulates flight. Do not attack soldiers whose temper is keen. Do not swallow bait offered by the enemy. Do not interfere with an army that is returning home. You have to know how to move quickly and swiftly. And more than that, you have to study the circumstances. A lot of people are looking for a guidebook. They want someone to tell them exactly what to do. That is a surefire way to lose because every situation is different. Principle 8 is you need variation in tactics. The art of war teaches us not to rely on the likelihood of the enemy's not coming, but on our own readiness to receive him. Not on the chance of his not attacking, but rather on the fact that we have made our position unassailable. According to Sun Tzu, there are 5 dangerous faults which may affect a general. Recklessness, which leads to destruction, cowardice, which leads to capture, a hasty temper, which can be provoked by insults, a delicacy of honor, which is sensitive to shame, and over-solicitude for his men, which exposes him to worry and trouble. So here's how you can fix these 5 dangerous faults. Don't be reckless. Be courageous. Know how to control your emotions. Don't be sensitive to shame and have a delicate honor. And don't be a bleeding heart for everyone who works for you. Principle number 9 is the army on the march. Now this principle usually deals with the nitty-gritties of warfare. It talks about the terrain and how you should fight. So it's not that useful for you and me. But here Sun Tzu says something that is of use to us. Soldiers must be treated in the first instance with humanity, but kept under control by means of iron discipline. This is a certain road to victory. If in training, soldiers' commands are habitually enforced, then the army will be well disciplined. If not, its discipline will be bad. This means that if you're a leader, you cannot be soft. Yes, you do need to be kind to the people you're leading, but it is your job to make sure that they understand who is in charge. If you don't do that, then your team will lack discipline, and lack of discipline will lead to decreased productivity. Principle 10 is terrain. You have to know what ground you're fighting on. If you know the enemy and know yourself, your victory will not stand in doubt. But if you know the terrain you're fighting on, you may make your victory complete. Here's a real-world application of this. If you're entering a new market and you know yourself and your competition well, but don't know the laws of the country you're going to fight in, then you still might lose. So you need to know everything about the environment you're going to engage your enemy in if you want a sure chance of victory. And principle 11 is the use of spies. Now Sun Tzu talks about the use of spies and how we need to be able to manage them if we want to win a war. But we don't have spies nowadays, at least not in our daily lives. But spies represent a very important point for us, and that is foreknowledge. We should know about the enemy from the inside, their secrets and their vulnerabilities. Now I'm not telling you to do something illegal, but in the real world this could mean making friends with employees of the other company, or even buying a product from your enemy so you can inspect it and see if you can find something that's wrong with it. There is one thing that is consistent throughout this book, and that is the fact that knowledge is power. Even though Sun Tzu talks about all kinds of military strategies, none of them would work if you didn't have enough knowledge. These principles will help you navigate any situation in which you have to win. That's all for this video. I hope you learned something new in this video, and if you did, then please click the like button, subscribe if you haven't already, and thanks for watching.